Good morning, everybody. Thank you so much for being here today for the celebration service. I know that Phyllis would be proud and pleased and excited. In fact, what you're going to experience today, she authored all of it. And if there's anything that Phyllis was, it is prepared, right? So she prepared it all and said, just paint by the numbers. Here's who I want. Here's the songs. Here's the people. And make it fun. So here we are today. So good to have you guys here with you. My name is Pastor Kennedy. I'm the lead pastor here at Southgate Church. I got to be Phyllis's pastor for the last few laps of her life. And let me tell you, it was absolutely fantastic to know this woman and to be a part of just some pretty incredible moments with her, which I'll share a little bit later. So we're here today to really celebrate and thank God for what he has done through somebody who lived a tremendous life for Christ, as a friend, as an aunt to many, whether you're related or not, Aunt Phil, you know. And my mother was visiting when I first came, and I said, I want you to meet Aunt Phil. And later she goes, I didn't know she was in the family. I go, nope, we're all in her family. That's how it goes. So she goes, okay. So my mom's calling her Aunt Phil. So just a wonderful, wonderful lady. And so we're going to enjoy today. So let's open our time with a time of prayer, shall we? Father, we come to you today and we want to say thank you. God, we praise you. We praise you for the work you do in people's lives. We thank you for your transforming power, the way you change and shape and mold. And Father, you bring the best out of us, and we thank you for that. And we just ask now, Jesus, that you would come and meet us at this point, at this place in the valley. Lord God, help us today, we pray, to be filled with your presence and your peace. I pray for the strength of the Lord to be with the family. God, put your arms around them. May they all feel the squeeze of God today, knowing that you're very close to them. You promised to be with all those who mourn, to be very, very close to them. And I just pray that the closeness of Jesus would be sensed in their hearts today. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let me do a little reading for you today. Phyllis J. Wallace, formerly Daugherty, 91. She says, Jeff, I just want to drive again. Yeah. Of South Bend, passed away peacefully and entered into the presence of the Lord, her Savior, on Saturday, October 2nd. She was born in Mishawaka, Indiana, to Foster and Madge Daugherty, and on April 4th, 1930, on her parents' fourth wedding anniversary. Her parents preceded her in death, as well as a sister, Marilyn Kay, and brother Jim. On July 25th, 1948, at Mishawaka Assemblies of God Church in Mishawaka, Indiana, she married Kenneth Wallace, and they celebrated their 52nd wedding anniversary before his death on March 5th in the year 2000. She is survived by her sister-in-law, Margaret Daugherty, nephew, Michael, and niece, Diane, and great-nieces, Katie, and Tim, Victoria, and Audrey, Carter, and Kayla, and Krista Daugherty, great-nephew, William, and a great-great-niece, Aaliyah Daugherty, and a great-great-nephew, the love of her life, always gave me the update on Bo. Let me tell you about Bo, Pastor. Oh. Good to bring Bo Bauman into the picture. God bless him, too. She graduated from Mishawaka High School class of 1948. She was employed at Uniroyal for 40 years. And 25 years of that time, she was a senior purchasing agent in the engineering system for fuel cell division. Retiring from Uniroyal in 1988, she became the plant manager for the Delta Star Electric Company. She worked for the Indiana Industrial Supply for 5 years and finished her career at the United Way at St. Joe County for 11 years as the Assistant Director and Community Services and Industrial Campaign Coordinator. She was devoted to her faith in Christ, and she was a member of Southgate Church, formerly known as Calvary Temple. For 59 years, Phyllis had a love for music, and she served as the church organist and a choir member for 30 years. She and her husband were very active in the senior adult ministries, and they served on the advisory committee. She belonged to the Mishawaka Alumni and Uniroyal Ladies Business Bureau. Phyllis enjoyed volunteering with Memorial Hospital Auxiliary for 11 years in the atrium gift shop. Phyllis was affectionately known as Aunt Phil to children and to adults alike. She and her husband have traveled extensively, visiting every state in the continental United States, as well as Alaska and Hawaii. Her hobbies consisted of crocheting baby and wounded warrior blankets, reading and feeding, studying birds, and flower gardening. She was quite a lady. Many, many more things about her. Amen? Many, many more things about her. One of her favorite scriptures that she wanted to have read was Psalm 100. And we would read that often when I would visit, and so I'm going to share that with you today. Psalm 100 says, "Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before his presence with singing. Ye know that the Lord, he is God, and that he hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are his people, the sheep of his pasture. Enter into his gates with thanksgiving, and into his courts with praise. And be thankful unto him, and bless his name. For the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations." One of the biggest parts of Aunt Phil's life is music. Oh man, she played and played and played. She played the organ here for so many years, and piano. She had an organ in her home, and she would play, and she loved the hymns. And so we are going to have Marcia Blue come, and she's going to lead us in singing the hymns. The words will be on the screen, so it doesn't matter what you sound like. Make a joyful noise, amen? Let Aunt Phil know that we're singing the music she picked. God bless you. Thank you, Marcia.
First song we're going to do is "Great Is Thy Faithfulness." That song just totally reminds me of Phyllis and her life and how God blessed her in her wonderful years, 91 years. So please sing along with me, even if you don't know it real well. There's a lot of you that will, so I'd want to hear those voices. So, great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow or turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, moon, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercy mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness, morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. The next song that Phyllis chose is a song that was really her heart, because she loved to tell us and tell me the story of Jesus. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell how the angels in chorus sang as they welcomed his birth. Glory to God in the highest, peace and good tidings to earth. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell me the stone in the desert, tell of the cross where they kneeled. Tell me the days of his presence, tell me sorry, they got the words off. Tell of his precious and earthen, tell of his labor and love, tell of the sorrow he bore me, oh, when he fled on the cross. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Marcia. This is one of the more precious times that we're going to get to spend today. I want to invite all of our family that want to say something about Aunt Phil to come join me on the platform, and we'll share these two microphones. So everybody come on up. It's really good to have everybody on the platform at the same time, because it kind of lends to comfort and encouragement, and the other people don't have to stand alone. So come on up. Yes.
I just wanted to share a couple, can you guys hear me? I just wanted to share a couple childhood memories. We have all the great nieces and nephew up here, and one great niece, great niece, and Beau's not here today because I don't know if you saw him yesterday, but he's a little bit wild, so we left him home. But we'll always remember very special times with Aunt Phil and Uncle Kenny at their house, especially on Lincoln Way. I know my sisters and I and my brother, we went there every Halloween, and It was always, we always looked forward to that, to seeing them. They were always so excited to see our costumes. I remember Aunt Phil and Uncle Kenny, for some reason, maybe it's because I'm pregnant, but all I can think about are treats right now. So they always had Juicy Fruit, Winter Fresh, Big Red Gum. Like, we would always go to their house and then immediately sneak off into the garage. And they knew we were doing it, but they always made sure it was full for us. And we always appreciated that. I really loved enjoying spending time with them. It was a special treat for us to get to go to the McDonald's play place with them. One thing I personally shared with Aunt Phil was a love for birds. And, sorry. Another thing is that she really, thank you. She really cherished Bo, and I know she was really looking forward to this next baby, and even in the last, you know, couple weeks when she couldn't respond very much, she still, I held her hand, and I just could feel that she was really looking forward to this baby, and we're just gonna really miss her a lot. She was a, I don't know how you say it, by age, she was a great aunt to us, but in reality, she was really a great person and a great aunt to all of us. So I think that's all I'm gonna have, so thank you.
How to compose yourself after that? First and foremost, for those of you who don't know, I'm Victoria. My favorite thing about Aunt Phil was that she never missed an opportunity to tell us how much she loved us and how special we were to her. I can't count the number of times she said that. Every time I saw her, I think. As Pastor alluded to earlier, she was incredibly talented, especially musically. I started taking piano lessons at a young age, and one of my favorite things to do was play the organ at Aunt Phil's house. There were all these buttons and levers, and I would push and press them all and hammer out something really pitiful, but she loved to listen to me play and would always encourage it. And I was amazed when she would take over, whether it was on the piano or the organ, and she would play and sing, and it was just came so naturally to her. It was beautiful. If you know her, she was always dressed to the nines. She always looked perfect and perfectly put together. Her nails were perfectly filed and polished, and one of the things that Katie, Audrey, and I will never forget was going to her house as kids, and she had, you would think, 50 different shades of nail polish perfectly lined up in her bathroom, and all of her perfumes, and we would just stand there as little girls and pick through each one and decide what was our favorite and which smell we liked, and I'll just never forget how beautiful her house was and how much time we enjoyed spending there.
My favorite thing about Aunt Phil was her strength. Aunt Phil was one of the strongest women that I've ever known. She had an incredible work ethic and perseverance in all aspects of her life. Whether it was fighting cancer multiple times, being the only woman in the room, being the only woman in a room full of businessmen, or being a leader in the church and of our family. She never took no for an answer, which I'm sure you all already knew. I hope she can rest well, knowing that her legacy of strength lives on in each of us up here. We miss her today and always, but she made an impact on this family that will last for lifetimes. We really miss and love her, and thank you guys so much for being here to celebrate her, because she deserves to be celebrated. She was an incredible woman.
Sorry, I don't have anything written down like everybody else did, but I was always really thankful for how proud of Aunt Phil was of her family. She always made an effort to be at any special event in our lives, whether it was me graduating from an Eagle Scout ceremony, the kids graduating from college, or somebody getting a new job, and she was always really, really proud of us, and I just wish that she would have been able to come to my college graduation, but she couldn't make it because of COVID. But I knew that she got to watch virtually, and she was proud of us.
I'm Jim, Diane's wife. I mean, and my my speech is not Margaret approved. So she was asking, what are you going to say? I said, well, I'm not going to tell you. So I met Diane 38 years ago, and we started dating seriously. So I met the whole family. So at that time, Phyllis and Kenny lived on Fur Road on a five-acre plot, nice barn. They had a horse, and they had two dogs, Sammy and Buffy. And Sammy was a dachshund, however you say that. And I think Sammy was deaf and blind at the time. But I remember going out there, and at 7 o'clock on the dot, those dogs would walk into the kitchen and sit in front of the refrigerator because it was vanilla ice cream time. Do you remember that? And the second thing I wanted to share was Phyllis was so organized, so clean. Her house was spick and span all the time. Even the garage, you could eat off the garage floor. It was unbelievable. Not so in my garage. If you can make it through the path in my garage, you get an award. And she would always say, Jim, Diane and I will help clean your garage. In fact, they did it once when I went on a business trip. It took me a month to find the stuff because it was all put away. So anyway, it was stuff we bantered about all the time. And I remember she told me when they moved to Lincoln Way, Kenny would go on these extended fishing trips. Alaska, he had to be flown in by bush plane, right? So she tells me one time, she goes, well, one time when Kenny went on his trip, it was 3 weeks, and they had two garages. They had the car garage, and then they had a wood shop garage with lathes and Dremels and all this. He was a beautiful cabinet maker. And she said, when he was up there, I completely cleaned his wood shop area, put everything away, got rid of all the sawdust. And if you guys knew Kenny, he was a soft-spoken person. So he gets back from that trip. He walks in, turns around. He didn't speak to her for 3 weeks. So she tells me the story. So the next time she's over, he goes, Jim, I said, remember this fishing trip story? She never mentioned it again. But I don't know what proverb it is. Cleanliness is next to godliness. Well, she's up in heaven now, and I think she probably polished the gates before she went through.
Thanks, family. Kim and Christopher, for being up here. Thanks, everybody, for coming today. She just, she would be so thrilled that you're here and that you're honoring her and today. So, Ampville, you got people who love you and be reunited with you in heaven someday. So we want to thank you for being here. Everyone, I don't need to speak on my behalf because you all know about how I felt about Aunt Phil. And so, but Margaret wants you to know what she's written something that she wants me to read. And so I'm going to do that. So Saturday, and I think I see the hairdresser back there. Diane is here. She said, Saturday I asked Phyllis's hairdresser to describe her. She said, gentle, kind, passionate, determined. She loved sharing her faith. She was devoted. Once you know her, you are family from then on. She had a strong work ethic, and anything she set her mind to, she could accomplish. Always willing to lend a helping hand, Margaret would add, strong, resilient, intolerant of injustice, consistent, generous, and forgiving, which we're all grateful for. Margaret met Phyllis in 1955 when she met and married her brother. The last 2.5 years, Margaret has spent a lot of time with Phil as her health declined. I can sum up her life in two words. She loved. Needed that, yeah. First of all, she loved God with all of her heart. She loved Kenneth Clayton Wallace with all of her heart. She met Kenny at church. So here's a funny stories that we remind ourselves about. So Phyllis came home from church one day, and she asked her mom if she could invite some friends over after church. So Grandma Doherty got refreshments together, probably, you know, some lemonade and cookies or whatever. And so Kenny arrived, okay? And they're enjoying his company for a little bit, and then they waited for a while, and then they waited a little longer. And her mother asked, when are the others coming? And she said, it's just Kenny. Kenny was the only one invited, and so that began a lovely courtship, and very exciting. She's the only one. So Phyllis was very close to her dad and a little spoiled. I don't know if we've ever said that before, but anyway, when Kenny asked for permission to marry her, okay, her dad said, "You don't want her. If you take her, you cannot bring her back." Okay, he was a lot of fun too. But he kept her for 54 years until they were parted by Kenny's home and going to heaven. She loved her family. She loved Kenny's family, for many of them are here. Kenny's family, wave your hand. Oh, just so wonderful that you're here to celebrate her. She loved her pastor, okay? She loved all the pastors, but this one here, that was a good one. She was glad you came, Pastor Jeff. She loved her neighbors. Where's her neighbors at? Yeah, right there they are. They loved her too. Her school friends, which some of them are here too, I think, and coworkers. You read her obituary. She worked a lot. So she loved her coworkers, and she loved all of you. She did. She loved all of you. She cared about this building. Okay, she cared about this building, and she asked often about the renovation. She was part of the renovations before. She loved that Linda was doing the renovations now and doing such a good job. But recently, she was in the hospital, and I was there. Pastor Jeff visited her, and her first question was, "Are the windows installed?" Right there, 1, 2, 3, 4. She was so excited about the windows. They're beautiful. So she loved this sanctuary, and she was thrilled. She was so excited about that cross. We talked about that cross for a long time, and it's stunning and represents such a wonderful thing that Jesus Christ did for us. And she loved that cross. So when she came, she loved looking at the cross. Excuse me. She loved hymns, which you can tell this is what she wanted. She wanted a hymn sing, okay? And she loved that. And she loved music. She excelled in traditional church music. She enjoyed her work, which I mentioned before. And she always stated, life was too short to not enjoy what you do for a living. Okay, so choose something that you love, okay? We talked about her dog already. Samuel Fitzpatrick Wallace was his name. And, yep, Jim told that great story, and it's true. The dog would walk to the refrigerator at that appointed time. She loved state parks, nature walks, sunshine, sunset. She loved the Cubs. Kenny was the New York Yankees. He was the Yankees, but she was the Cubs, okay? And she also enjoyed a T-bone steak. And Kenny had some health issues, and he was on a restricted diet. She was never eating in front of him, but she always enjoyed having a good steak. And she enjoyed salmon patties. You probably had salmon patties at her house. Salmon patties, meatloaf, ham hock, and beans. Hopefully, people, you know what that is. I'm not sure. But at Thanksgiving and other times, we had to hold the turkey hearts and gizzards for her. Okay? That was from growing up on the farm and all that. On her 88th birthday, Margaret and I took her to Boston. See the girls? They lived in Boston, where she enjoyed seeing the magnificent churches where our forefathers worshipped. Okay? She enjoyed birthday celebrations. So when we were there, she and Kenny liked to watch Cheers, okay, for years. So we took her to Cheers on her birthday, and everybody knew her name, okay? They got up, it's Phyllis's birthday, and they all got up and sang happy birthday to her at Cheers in Boston. That was a lot of fun. So on Memorial Day this year, we went to celebrate our May birthdays, and she enjoyed every moment. You guys might have seen I posted a picture on Facebook that she was all wrapped up in a blanket, but she was outdoors, she loved the beach, and she enjoyed going to the beach with us often. She was born on Easter Sunday, and her mother stated that she arrived just in time for Sunday school. Okay? So her birthday this year landed on Easter Sunday again, and we had a great celebration at our house and took some great pictures. So if she could talk to us today, she would say, "Don't grieve for me. Miss me. okay? But don't grieve for me, because I am happy and I'm pain-free. I'm home. She would say, she would ask you to stay faithful, to love and care for one another, to show love and kindness, to share Jesus, and make a difference. So she loves you, and she will meet you again at God's appointed time. Okay.
All right.
One of the things that I would say about Phyllis Wallace is that she is formidable. She is formidable. I'm very thankful. She had a great love for the Assemblies of God, which is the fellowship that this church is a part of. And in fact, she served the seniors in our district by being on the team that put together the big retreat for all the seniors. So once a year, they would have a seniors retreat. Phyllis was part of that. She was playing music for that. And so she knew the leadership of the fellowship. In the transition between my predecessor and I, there was a time, you know, where, you know, they were very careful. It took a long time in their search process, and so they're just going along, and you add leadership, and all things happen. Somebody forgot to call our district superintendent, so he's kind of like the little pope of the area, right? So you kind of want to let him know what's. So anyway, so he had found out that this church was out of pastor, and he called and he said, hey, I'd like to come and meet with the board. And the board's like, no, it's not necessary. You don't need to meet with us. That's like your mother telling you, you're going to come home for dinner. No, I don't need to really come home for dinner, you know. And so he goes, no, you don't understand. This is customary. We need to get together. No, it's okay. We don't. So he says, I'm coming. So as he's driving up here, not knowing what he was going to find, he calls Phyllis. And he says, Aunt Phil, what's going on? And he goes, oh, Don, you just need to show up at that church like their dad. They just don't know the process, you know. Just show up like their dad. Phyllis, her counsel changes courses and directions. And I got to be here. So I am so glad she said, just show up as their dad. And so I thought, man, that is so good. And so here I am, ta-da, right? So then on my very, very first Sunday, this is when the word formidable came to my mind. My first official Sunday, it was a June Sunday, I was in the prayer room customarily with everybody praying, but I hear a commotion out in the hallway. And I thought, well, I wonder what that is. So I go out into the hallway, and I stick my head out, and it's Phil with an entourage. And so I step out, and I go, well, hey, Phil, what's up? And she says, Pastor, there are shorts on the platform. And I said, is there anybody in them? And that began our love affair, me and Phyllis, you know, because then she thought, okay, this is going to be a fun run, and it's going to be a fun run. And so her and I have just worked together. She actually was on my, one thing that wasn't in the accolades, she was on our staff here. She was my visitation pastor. I deputized her, and she went out and visited the sick. And she just put the miles on the car, and out they went and did communion. And, I mean, she was in our staff meetings, and just a real part of who we are. And so I'm just really grateful that I could just be a part of that. And the other thing I just want to share before we move on today is... I got to, you know, I visited often the last several weeks of her life, and I asked her, I said, Phil, how do you feel with the diagnosis of the brain cancer? She goes, I just feel a little foggy. I said, really? She said, yeah, but I can talk, but I just feel a little cloudy. I said, oh, and she goes, and I remember, the youth group still has to clean my garage floor. I remember, so we will. Clean that garage floor, okay? We said we would. We will do that. She will remember, okay? And so then after that, you know, she's, you know, as I was watching her just getting ready to go home to be with the Lord, I can tell you, every time I go in, I take my mask off. Do you know who I am? Yes, you're Pastor Jeff. Every time, yes, you're Pastor Jeff. How are you feeling? I'm okay. the Lord's making a way for me. And then I would just sit and I would read her the word. We would sing together. Then she would fall asleep, all right? And then every time after that church, when she would wake up, she would lift her hands and she would just worship Jesus. Every time. Up until the day before, I was with her the day before she slipped into heaven. I walk in, hi, Phil, do you know who I am? Yes, I know who you are. And the very last thing Phyllis Wallace said to me was one of the first things that she said when I came, and that is, I love you, and I will love you forever. And that's my Aunt Phil today. And so I'm just glad to be a part of this great family who has a woman who is formidable, but quite lovely. So one of the things that she wanted to have shared with us today is a reading, which is pretty cool, and it's called A Walk Through the Bible, and we've asked Pastor Kathy Holdeman to come and to read that to us today. So would you please welcome Kathy Holdeman. Bless you.
Wonderful woman today. And I always wanted to emulate Aunt Phil's strength. She walked into a room and you knew she had presence and she was a strong woman. And because of her love for Jesus, that strength was well-manned. It wasn't out of character, it was never ugly. It was a strength that was seen through the precious love of Jesus. So, Billy Sunday's Walk Through the Bible, written, just so you understand the language, written sometime between 1893 and 1935. Aunt Phil was a woman of tradition, right? So he writes, with the Holy Spirit as my guide, I enter the wonderful temple of Christianity. I enter the portico of Genesis, walk down the Old Testament art galleries where pictures of Noah, Abraham, Moses, Joseph, Isaac, Jacob, and Daniel were hung on the walls. I pass into the music room of Psalms where the Spirit swept the keyboard of nature until it seemed that every reed and pipe in God's great organ responded to the tuneful harp of David, the sweet singer of Israel. I entered the chamber of Ecclesiastes where the voice of the preacher was heard, and into the conservatory of Sharon where the lily of the valley's sweet scented spices filled and perfumed my life. I entered the business office of Proverbs and then into the observatory room of the prophets, where I saw telescopes of various sizes pointed to far-off events, but all concentrated on the bright and morning star. I entered the audience room of the King of Kings, caught a vision of his glory from the standpoint of Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, passed into the Acts of the Apostles, where the Holy Spirit was doing his work in the formation of the infant church. Then into the correspondence room where sat Paul, Peter, James, John, penning their epistles. I stepped into the throne room of Revelation where towered the glittering peaks and got a vision of the King sitting upon the throne in all his glory. And I cried, all hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all.
Thank you. I just wanted to introduce the preacher for you today because, brother, you set the bar for me at this church. Everything he does, Aunt Phil tells me, oh, he just got elected. Oh, she is so proud of you, Ralph. You're a reverend, you're a man of God, but you are family, and she loves you so much. And she always told me, now, Pastor, don't feel bad, but you're not preaching my funeral. Don't feel bad. Now, it's Ralph. I didn't know it wasn't Ralphie, because that's all she ever called, so I apologize. The first time I saw her, I said, hey, what's up, Ralphie? He goes, nobody calls me that but my Aunt Phil. But Reverend Ralph, would you please come, bring us the word, and I want you to know she loves you so much.
Thank you, Pastor.
It's an honor to have you with us. God bless you.
Well, it is an honor.
And it is a joy to be with you today. We
We all don't know each other, but we all knew Aunt Phil, and as I share my heart today, you'll realize we are talking about the same gal. Amen, somebody. Yeah. We are so grateful for all that God is going to do. Before I share, would you come and sing "To God Be the Glory"? And we're going to just give you a chance to focus on the good things of the Lord and just praise Him and worship Him. And let's just focus our attention on Him for a few moments.
Last time I was here in South Bend to come to another friend's funeral, I always stopped by and would sit with Phyllis out on her lovely little screened-in porch that she built for herself, and she always just wanted to sit and sing with me and harmonize and just reminisce about, you know, the good old days, and we had such a wonderful time together always. But she was like a spiritual mom to me, you know. I could always call her when I just needed some, you know, some advice or some help, and she would always just have these wisdom, gems of wisdom for me. And my family loved her, and it was such a privilege to be asked to come and sing for her. And I was surprised at the song she picked that she wanted me to sing. But when I started really getting into the words, it just made all the sense in the world. It's my tribute. The things He has done for me, things so undeserved, that He gave His only life for me. The voices of a million angels could not express all that I am and ever hope to be. I owe it all to Thee. To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God.
Thank you. Can we stand and just lift our hands for a moment and just give the Lord praise and worship? Father, we thank you for the love of God that has been shed abroad in our hearts, that while we were yet sinners, Jesus Christ died for us. Lord, we've come to celebrate an amazing woman of God. And Lord, because she lived for you and served you, we know where she is, and where she is, we long to be. And God, we give you the praise for all the things that you have done in my dear Aunt Phil. And in her life and through her life, the difference in the countless hundreds and thousands of people she affected. And God, we just give you praise for your goodness. Bring your continual comfort and peace in these moments ahead. In Jesus' name, everyone said amen. Well, you may be seated. Pastor, it is a joy to be with you today. I greet you in the name of Jesus, and to Mike and Nancy and to Jim and to Diane and Margaret and all these beautiful nieces and one nephew, William. Man, you are famous, young man. I have a word that the Lord really has spoke to my heart. I spoke to Diane a few days ago, and we were talking about this service. And as I hung up the phone, this thought came to me. That was then, this is now. That was then, this is now. And I just couldn't escape that phrase. I want to share a moment on some of my memories of Aunt Phil, on this incredible, remarkable woman that was then, the things that she accomplished. You know, she was very successful and talented, and everything she did, she won at. Amen, somebody. She was a multifaceted, endless woman of skill and talent, planning and organizing. She had this never take no for an answer thing about her. She had a can-do spirit, and it was an incredible joy to have her as a part of the fabric of our life. Growing up, it was Aunt Phil, Uncle Kenny, Aunt Phil, Uncle Kenny. I mean, they were just heroes in our family and precious, and they were always there for us. You know, she was, I thought about the word strength. First thing comes to mind, and she was a woman of boldness and conviction. And can I just be honest, a little stubborn? She was a leader. I also remember her beauty. She was just always put together. Those who knew her as a very young lady, she was stunning, like a movie star or a model. Today at Beeger School over on Lincoln Way in Mishawaka, they are singing a fight song she wrote. Yes, about 80 years ago, she wrote the Beeger fight song. She told me that because I went to Emmons in the junior high, and we didn't like Beeger, and she just let me know, you know. You know, hundreds of families and thousands of people in the South Bend area are still being affected by her generosity, her hard work for United Way. She worked with and worked for many very successful, rich businessmen, and for the most part during a time where it was still kind of a man's world. And they would walk in, and she would come to a meeting, or they would come into her office, and they would just very easily use foul language. And she said, "Listen to me. I'm a lady, and I'm a Christian. You're not going to talk that way around me." And you know what they said? "Yes, ma'am." She was an incredible, very precious woman. You know, she handled her business and conducted her life with such a spirit of excellence. Everything she did well. Am I talking about the same woman? She had a thing that just was a tasteful class about her, and incredibly, incredibly, amazingly strong. You know, it's said about a lot of people, they have their act together. But let me tell you something about my Aunt Phil. She had her act together. You were glad she was on your side. Amen, somebody. She was a winner. Yet today, we don't celebrate only her accomplishments, only the great things she did, her victories, her talents, her successes. What I think that stood out most about me was she was probably the most relational person I've ever known. Proverbs 17:17 says, "A friend loves at all time." And indeed, if she was your friend, she was loyal, and she loved you with this incredible, contagious joy, and you were family. There's no one that I've ever known that has probably attended more graduations, more birthday parties, more holidays, more showers, more funerals, more weddings, more socials, more get-togethers, more reunions, more graduations, more potlucks than Aunt Phil, and she probably organized and planned most of them. If you knew her, you knew her well, and she knew you well. She just knew people, and she remembered their names. If you wanted to know anything about anybody, just call her, and she would tell you, yeah, that was so-and-so, so-and-so's nephew, so-and-so's niece. She had a real interest in the people that she loved. You know, sometimes people who are good talkers are not good listeners, but she was both. You know, I've got to be honest with you. When she'd call, you know, I'd say, oh, boy, there's Aunt Phil. I want to talk to her, but I am so busy. I don't have an hour, you know. And so sometimes I would say, hey, Aunt Phil, how are you doing? I'm in the middle of something. What's going on? Just try to get her to not talk so long. It didn't work. It did not work. She had a genuine concern, and she was a real sincere friend. Well, she also loved her mom and dad. She was so appreciative. I love the story about how Grandpa Doherty said, you're going to take her, but you're not going to give her back. Amen, somebody. It was just an incredible, incredible story. At the age of 23, her sister Marilyn, who passed away, was 11. She was so close to Jim, so close to Jim. And, you know, I am the youngest, and I'll say that kind of with a little pride. I am the youngest of all of Uncle Kenny's nieces and nephews. And some of the other old folks that are nieces and nephews, Uncle Kenny, are here today. Sherry Joe was right a little older than me, but I'm the youngest, and I was always the favorite on that side of the family. Yeah, and Pastor said, nobody in the world got away with it, but when she called me Ralphie, it was a term of endearment, and I said, yes, Aunt Phil, it's Ralphie. Oh. The reality is they loved us, and we loved them, and, you know, I remember how deeply she loved Uncle Kenny. You know, they had this house on Lincoln Way, and it was right next door to Aunt Madge. We called Grandma Doherty Aunt Madge, and Aunt Madge had on her wall the song, Great is Thy Faithfulness. You walked in, and it was right there. And she loved Aunt Madge. She cared for Aunt Madge. Well, Uncle Kenny was an incredible, talented, could do anything and make anything and build everything. And I remember when the conversation was that we bought some land on Fur Road and we're going to build a home there. Now, Uncle Kenny went out and he built a beautiful state-of-the-art country home to every specification and every detail the inspector, Aunt Phil, gave him. And it was an incredible, beautiful home, and they enjoyed their horse Lucky, and Sammy was out there, and we'd go visit them, and he just made this beautiful, just picture-perfect show home. And then, as Aunt Madge's health deteriorated, she got older, they sold that beautiful country home and moved back into that little house on Lincoln Way so they could be next door to Aunt Madge to take care of her again. My question is, who does that? They were both so caring, so loving, and so generous. They lived a full life together. They walked 52 years through the hardships, the betrayals, the challenges, the painful moments, the health problems, the family problems, the church problems, but they overcame. Interesting enough, on March 3rd, 2000, I stood right here on this very spot to share and preach at Uncle Kenny's funeral. At that moment, she remember standing at the casket, and she said, Ralphie, you know, a lot of people may not know this, but Uncle Kenny and I had our share of problems. It wasn't always easy. I did not know he gave her the silent treatment for 3 weeks for cleaning that shop, but that makes perfect sense. Don't mess with a man's shop and tools. Uncle Kenny and I both share the love of woodworking. She said, you know what? We forgave, we forgot, and we loved. And I will always look back at this memory, even as a young man, it was mentioned Uncle Kenny was a very quiet, unassuming, soft-spoken man. He would have a pencil in his ear and sawdust in his hair, and then there is Aunt Phil. I mean, put together, I mean, sharp. It was just incredible. She was always gorgeous, confident, bold, this empowered woman, opinionated, and then Uncle Kenny. But you know what? Their love saw them through, and they made it work. And they did a great job at showing people how to have a home of respect and love and a marriage of kindness. She was an amazing, talented musician. It was mentioned she could play the piano. She could play the organ. She had a beautiful voice and ability to harmonize and sing. For years, she traveled with some friends in a trio. I remember them singing a song at County Line. You can have a song in your heart at night after every trial, after every mile. But anyone can sing when the sun's shining bright. But you need a song in your heart at night. My heart was moved today by the testimony of her dear nieces and nephew, their love and their admiration for her. You know, we could spend all day talking about this incredible, amazing, one-of-a-kind woman. But you know what? Most funerals end there. Most funerals focus on what was then, what their lives was like then, what they accomplished then, their work then, their hobbies then, how she cooked great then, how she cleaned her house then. But the reality is, this cannot be an average, ordinary funeral, because she was no average and ordinary woman of God. I want to take a moment to think about now. Now. Yes, her life was incredible for 91 years, but what about now, these last 11 days? You see, we have got this errant viewpoint that life ends at death. Nothing could be further from the truth. Death is a portal. Death is a door. Death is an entrance. Death is not the end. For every believer, death does not get the final word. Death is just the very beginning. In fact, her life, the life she was destined to live, the life that God had planned for her, began the moment she took her last breath 11 days ago. She stepped into what God had meant for her all along. This perfect, unbelievable, unimaginable life in heaven, this wonderful paradise. And I would be remiss if I allowed our thoughts to just be about our precious Aunt Phil and the life she lived then. There's a now. There's a story. In fact, her story is just beginning. It has been said that eternity is like this. Take a pencil and make a dot. From that dot, draw a line that never stops, that goes on and on and on, millions and billions and billions of miles. From that dot goes an unending line. That dot is the life on this earth. Interesting enough, there's a long, unbelievable, because I don't know about eternity, but I know it's a long time. There is an unbelievable eternity following the ending of that dot. God's put eternity in our hearts. You all have it. I have it. We have been gifted with eternity. If you say that life ends at death, you merely are expressing you do not understand the power of our eternal God. God had no beginning, had no end. He is eternal. And he placed that when he breathed in us, our soul is eternal. Our spirit is eternal. And our bodies just hold that. Our bodies, our temples will decay. They will get sick and they will die. There's an appointment for our body to die, but there's no appointment for our spirit to die. It goes on and on and on. Here's the unfortunate thing, everybody. Most people, and some of us today in this room, all of our focus, all of our attention is on the dot. How can I make my dot happy? How can I be successful in that little teeny dot? And there's very little thought. And it's not accidental. It's a conspiracy of the enemy. There's very little thought as where I will spend eternity, where my life that will never end will be. The Bible is clear, you don't die. Your body, this tabernacle, will dissolve, and it will give way to death, and it will succumb, and it will be overcome, and it will be hijacked by cancer and sickness and disease and heart problems and all the things that we face in this body. But this body is simply a house that you are really living in. When it passes, you step into eternity. The moment you breathe your last breath, you are in eternity. Do not make the mistake that billions of people make to think that, oh, I'm all about that dot. Who can make me happy? How can I win in that dot? The reality is the culmination of things, it really doesn't matter the house you've owned, what kind of car you have, your career, how talented you were, how put together you were. What really matters is what happens when you breathe your last breath. Where will your line be? Revelation 21 and 4 says, here's how life looks for Aunt Phil. God wipes away all tears. There'll be no more pain. There'll be no more sorrow. All the former things have passed away. Revelation 14, 13, and the Lord will say, rest from your labors. Your works have followed you. Listen, Aunt Phil fought the good fight. She was not just an amazing woman. She was an amazing Christian woman. She would not compromise in her stand of God's word and her value. She loved the Lord. She loved the word. She had a beautiful heavenly prayer language. She knew the Lord intimately. She fought the good fight, and she finished her race, and she kept her faith. The Lord has prepared a place for her. Well, what about the now? 1 Corinthians 2 and 9 says, eye hath not seen nor ear heard, has it entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for those who love him. Paul writing in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 17, for our light affliction is but for a moment, and it works for us a far more eternal, exceeding weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but we look at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Right now, for these past several days, let's think about her life. Well, she got to meet Uncle Kenny again. Hallelujah. And I'm sure that all the sawdust is out of his hair. And you know, he was a Wallace, and Wallaces notoriously had a little speech thing going on. I don't know if you knew that. We called it Dutchy. They just, and it flows sometimes into my family. Sometimes we talk a little Dutchy. There was a little speech thing with Uncle Kenny, and that's gone. He speaks perfect now. He's speaking that heavenly language without any impediment. He has a strong heart. The last several years of his life, heart attacks, and you know, they were in a terrible accident. I don't know if you remember this, on Highway 31 near Kokomo, a truck come out of nowhere, did not stop, and broadsided them and almost took their life. They had no business living through that accident. The accidents, the problems, the heart problems, all the things they went through. Uncle Kenny now is in perfect health. She is in perfect health. There's no more suffering. There's no more aging. There's no more dying. And this is not a fairy tale. This is what life is about. The main business and objective of this life is to prepare for that life. There's really 2 days that ever matter. That day, the day she gave her heart to the Lord, and that day and this day, the day when she stood before the Lord and he said, hey, Aunt Phil, well done. Well done, good and faithful servant. You've been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many. Boy, she likes that. You get to be in charge. She goes, just like it was down there. Uh-huh. A large and in charge. Amen, somebody. And she said, okay, well done. You've been faithful. I will make you rule over many things. Enter into the joy of the Lord. She loved to smile. She loved to laugh. She loved to sing. Now, with no restrictions, she can sing and rejoice and move. And her body and her mind and her spirit
rest in the power of God. Philippians 1:21, for me to live is Christ, but to die is gain. She entered in to the now. That was then, this is now. Now she's happy. Completely happy. No problems, no challenges, no worries, no anxieties, no pressures, no stress. And then she met her mom and dad, her sister. And then she met Grandma Grandpa Wallace. And then she met Ralph and Rose Holderman. And my oldest sister, for sure, Janet. She met those she prayed about. And I just want to say this to all of you. There's not one person sitting here that she didn't pray for, that she didn't have on her heart, that she didn't love. She said to me one time in a conversation, we were talking about this day, and I was just saying, you know, Aunt Phil, you were so successful because in the ministry, whether we like it or not, we're fundraisers. Pastors have to raise a lot of money to do the work of ministry. We have to talk about that. And I've talked about it. We've raised money for the kingdom of God. And I was just filling her out and trying to get her to unpack her success in the United Way. I mean, she broke records and she just made thousands upon thousands of dollars, probably into the millions for sure, for the people and the businesses. And she said, well, honey, I went in and I presented the need and I gave them an opportunity. And I thought, yeah, but what was unspoken was, and you're not going to hear no. And she said, I just gave them an opportunity. And then she said, you know, when you preach my funeral, I want you to do just that. I want you to present the need and give them an opportunity. And I said, yes, ma'am. Jesus is the only way to get to heaven. There's not a lot of other ways. He's not the best of many ways. He's the only way. I am the way, the truth, the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. And I want to say, dear family, dear friends, she has one request. It was a song that she was asked to sing and really struggled through, to be honest, at my dad's funeral in 1992. Mom said, I want Aunt Phil to sing, Will the Circle Be Unbroken? And I'll never forget her standing there. The music began to play, and tears began to stream down her face. And she began to cry and break. When the song talked about, will the circle be unbroken? Now listen, family. This dear aunt that we love, Aunt Phil, is in heaven, not because of her good works, not because she had it together, but because she received Christ as Savior and Lord and lived her life for Jesus. He's the only entrance. And she cares for you and she loves you. And she said to me, Ralphie, there may be and there probably will be people at my funeral that are not serving the Lord. And would you just ask them to join in with the circle? Would you give them an opportunity? And so I'm going to do that. I want you to bow your heads with me. And I'm just going to pray, and just in a moment then, I'm going to give you a chance to pray with me. Father God, it has been a privilege and joy to share today your wonderful word, your truth. I thank you, Lord, that today I know my dear aunt has been united, reunited with her family, where there is no heartbreak, no disappointment, no worry, no need. Life, as it is intended, is being fully lived now by Aunt Phil. And God, she had this deep, fierce, incredible love for her family. And Lord, she was proud of them, and she attended all their events, and She brought gifts and she made things and she always went the extra mile. But I know today her number one desire is that when these in this service breathe their final breath, they too would find entrance and gain entrance into heaven. Now, Lord, that's her will, that's your will, that's our will. God, it is your will that no one perish but all come to repentance. For God so loved this world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him would not perish, should not perish, but have everlasting life. Holy Spirit of the living God, walk in this room right now and begin to draw people to you. Does not matter the life we've lived to this point, the errors, the mistakes, the habits, the tendencies. What matters now is we have an opportunity. Yes, we do. We have a chance today. The greatest opportunity of all is to say, Jesus, I accept you as Savior and Lord. Now, God, I ask, as much as Aunt Phil was driven and as much as she was, as Pastor said, formidable, she nor I nor anyone else can make these folks do anything. It's only by their own volition, by their own desire, can they come to you. Holy Spirit, draw them now. Do a work in their hearts. In Jesus' name. Now listen, everybody. I don't know. Just remain with your heads bowed. I don't know very many, and I certainly don't know where you stand with the Lord. I have one way to find out. That is to ask. It's the only way I know. So I'm going to do that. First question. There will only be two. Is this. I know I'm ready to meet God. When I die, I too, without any hesitation, I'm going to heaven. If that is what you feel in your heart, that's what you know to be true, I'm going to ask you to raise your hand and testify about that right now. Well, there were some who couldn't raise their hand. And I just want you to know, Aunt Phil has one desire, that you make your peace with God. Don't let your heart be hard. Don't let the things of the world keep you away. You know how she loved the Lord, and you know that he loves you. My question for you today is, are you going to keep living a life that you know is in jeopardy of eternal life in the Lord? You know, wouldn't it be great if when you get to heaven, you would say, Aunt Phil, it was at your funeral that I gave my heart back to the Lord. It was at your funeral that I came to Jesus. Oh, what a tribute. What a testimony. Some of you have served the Lord in the past, and maybe you're not serving him now. It's time to come home. It's time to come home. So here's the second question. You'd say, Ralph, I know I'm not right with God, but I need to be. And when you pray, would you just remember me? Of course, we're not going to call anybody out. No one's going to know, just you and me. But if you say, I need Jesus, I know I do. And I'm going to pray, and I'm going to turn some things around with his help. Would you raise your hand right now? Let me see those hands. Mm-hmm. Hands are being raised. Thank you. You can put them down. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I pray for these who have said, I need the Lord. God, I pray right now they would call upon you. Just ask him. You know how to ask him. Come into my heart, Jesus, right now. Forgive me my sins and let me live for you. I will do my best. You help me in my weakness, yes, and I will live my life for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. We just praise you and give you the glory. You are such a good and mighty God. Amen. Amen.
Lord.
Jesus, more, more about Jesus, more of his saving fullness see, more of his love who died for me, more about Jesus would I know, more of his grace to the others show, more of his saving fullness see, more of his love who died for me. Sing it with me. More, more about Jesus, more, more about Jesus, more of his saving fullness see, more of his love who died for me.
Would everybody stand with me to sing this last hymn that Phyllis picked out for us? Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Amen.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. I think of my blessed Redeemer. I think of him all the day long. I sing, for I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child and forever I am. I know I shall see in his beauty the King of this mansion for me. I soon with the Spirit made perfect, at home with the Lord I shall be. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, his child.
Praise God. Would you just do me a favor and stretch your hand toward the family right here for Margaret, not only a sister-in-law, but a dear friend, and Diane, and how she took care of Aunt Phil. What a friend. For Jim and for Mike, while he loved Aunt Phil, and for Nancy and their family and all these nieces, their spouses. Would you just do that right now? Father, the days ahead will not be easy. A big part of their lives will be missing. But Lord, we haven't lost her, because when you lose something, you don't know where it is. We know where she is. We haven't lost her. We know where she is.
And I pray, Holy Spirit, you just comfort them, put your arms around them, bring peace into their spirit. Let them live for you with steadfast love and joy, and may they have strength and power to prevail and to conquer and just live a life that is filled with your grace. And we thank you for that in Jesus' name. And everybody said amen. You know, we're going to move into the dismissal, so you may be seated. Michael has put together a beautiful tribute, a video of Aunt Phil for her. And I want to thank this pastor and this church for being such gracious host, and for all of you that come. Following the dismissal, the church has provided a lunch for us, a gathering together, and please make sure you are here for that lunch. God bless you.